Welcome to the Scariest Things Podcast, your gateway to the trends and tropes of the horror genre. This is episode 169, where we are talking kung fu horror. This is Mike Campbell, and I'm joined by
Eric Lee
and
Liz Williams.
All right. Eric is hyped for kung fu horror. Who suggested kung fu horror, by the way?
This is Liz.
Liz suggested.
Yeah, I said martial arts. Here is why.
Okay. Yeah, I want to hear.
And this is going to kind of get into some of my picks also. I felt like there was a lot more martial arts horror that was good.
Uh-huh.
I was wrong. A couple movies that was standing out in my head. I was like, man, we got to have a topic so I can talk about these.
Heck yeah.
some of them. And it's also hard to tell, are they horror or is it just people are so bloody and beaten?
Yep.
And action kind of that, you know, that's the horror is that people are just getting their asses kicked constantly. So this was, my suggestion. I thought it was like, I'm going to rock this. And I was like, oh my God, I turned off so many movies. I think I turned off more movies for this topic than I ever have.
Woo.
But thankfully, Tubi has a wealth of martial arts horror.
Yeah, they do.
I was bummed and I was banking on Tubi helping me out, but the movies that I really wanted to find struck out at Tubi, struck out at Movie Madness. Because I was going, I think my, just spoiler alert, I'm going all old school Hong Kong, Asia stuff.
I did not only all old school Hong Kong, Asia, I did all Shaw Brothers.
We might collide a couple of times because I've got a couple of Shaw Brothers.
Okay. Well, this is what I found about kung fu horror in at least the kung fu horror films I watched. Lots of maggots, lots of throwing up, lots of eating the throw up.
We did not mix.
And lots of hopping. Here's the thing I think is interesting as Liz was alluding to earlier is that these horror films. The kung fu horror films are so god-awful complicated that we would spend an entire podcast episode just trying to recap one film. They're almost impossible to explain, and after you watch them, it's like you had a fever dream where you don't even know what you just watched. And if somebody came to you and said, hey, tell me about this film, you'd be like, I have no goddamn idea what I just saw. And I'm not saying that there's like, I don't think it's like that it's a massive like cultural difference, because I don't think that's it. I think these films are just goddamn weird as hell.
Yeah, and
they are so weird.
Guaranteed there is also some lost in translation stuff. There are I think I'm somewhat divorced from my heritage. I can't speak Cantonese.
Right.
And I don't understand. I mean, other than good morning and happy new year and reading a menu, or not even reading a menu, but being able to order food. That's about the limitation.
15.
And I know some things from handed down from my folks, like what is a dustpan and what is an elephant? Not very handy.
Right.
Watching horror movies.
Yeah, not when, and so you're watching this and you can see the translation.
You're cleaning up vomit from the horror movie. You do need
the
dustpan.
Yeah.
Get the dustpan.
There's vomit everywhere.
Clean up those chunks. No, I think that's an encouraging sign because none of my movies involve like heavy use of vomit. So,
oh my Lord.
No one's going to overlap with me because none of mine are old. Not really old.
Oh, well, good. Well, Liz, what do you got, speaking of?
Yeah.
All right. I'll kick it off then. And I am kicking it off with first, we talked about, is wrestling a martial art? And I trust the internet and evolvemma.com, and it is considered one of the oldest martial arts because it relies on leverage, strong balance, explosive power, and technical knowledge to control and take down an opponent and maintain a superior position. So I went wrestling, and I went with a 2011 horror comedy called Monster Brawl.
And what?
This is made by JT Cook, who made Cult Hero, one of my favorites from last year. And this is starring Dave Foley from Kids in the Hall, Jimmy Hart, the famed wrestling like promoter, Kevin Nash, who is Big Sexy, the actual wrestler in WWE, and a whole cast of characters, because it is set in a wrestling style fight to the death, like to look like a pay-per-view inside an abandoned and cursed graveyard. And it is monsters fighting each other. Eight classic movie monsters: Cyclops, Swamp Gut, Frankenstein's Monster, Lady Vampire, Werewolf, Mummy, Witch Bitch, and Zombie Man. They have a monster brawl, and it is narrated by God, voiced by Lance Henriksen. So
what? I have never heard of or seen the poster for. Oh my God, that is insane.
So it's monster pretty brawl. Much like you're Have you ever heard of Monster Brawl? I've never heard of it. Pay-per-view for a fake wrestling match, but it looks like, you know, the ones that are on TV. And Dave Foley is your color commentator on the matches. It is completely ridiculous, stupid, stoopid. And JT Cook is just, he's a funny guy. And,
yeah.
All right.
It's ridiculous, and wow. You can see it on Tubi.
Yay.
Oh, yeah. See, okay.
Good job, Tubi.
If I
would put Monster Ball like in the background when you're having like a party or people over. Like, you don't want to sit there and like munch popcorn watching this movie.
You don't want to dissect Monster
heavy.
Brawl.
Yeah. You want to have it on while you're doing something else.
Well, I'm going to, if just as a little throw-ins, since you've got some wrestling in there, mm-hmm. I would have to go, if you're putting wrestling, you have to go the Lucha Libre.
Yeah.
Oh, sure, yeah.
I'd have the wrestling women versus the Aztec mummy, and then and Santo versus any number of his villains. But
the Martians.
Like,
Santo
versus
the Martians.
I wasn't wrestling, but I had to have something that I watched and didn't turn off to get the free.
Yeah, no, I think Santo versus the Vampire Woman would be my pick of the Santo series. Anyhow, just because you brought to the table, I'm allowing the whole, yeah. And plus you're the mayor, you can pick it out whatever you want.
I get to do whatever I want. No. So. It has real horror monsters. So
yeah, I want to see it now.
It's
see that's the whole
really
purpose
silly.
Of
really silly.
Of being your art the gateway to the trends and tropes
uh-huh.
is finding
right.
finding nuggets like this.
That's yeah. right. Yeah. That's right.
So
all right, who's next?
All right, so I'm gonna go. I'm gonna travel across the pond.
Yeah.
The bigger pond, the Pacific, to. I guess my inheritance of love of old school kung fu. This is a Shaw Brothers movie, and
yeah.
we will be talking more about the Shaw Brothers later. I know
a
that.
A lot. Yeah.
This is a 1982 movie called Human Lanterns.
Oh, yeah.
Starring,
super great.
Starring
super
Tony
great.
Liu, Quan Tai Chun, and Li Lo. This is maybe the best looking Shaw Brothers movie I've ever seen from a cinematography,
sure.
the camera work, because traditionally, everybody knows what the Shaw Brothers, famous for their fight choreography, famous for their wire work, not famed for how good their stuff looks on film. That those old 70s things, they often speed the stuff up so that they
mm-hmm.
so that the action looks more pronounced, but it's like, whoa, and it doesn't make a whole lot of sense because it's just moving too fast. But it is the go-to the legends of kung fu. Occasionally they dip into horror. So Human Lanterns is about about two lords in I think it's Chongqing, where there's a vengeful craftsman Lo Li who he's a creeper. He's a weird dude who's been hired by one of two noblemen who are hyper competitive. And they are going to try. They're going to have the city's lantern contest. And this guy was the Lo Lie was the was beaten in kung fu combat by Lao Wing, who ended up humiliating him, taking his bride to be, and he has sworn a quiet vengeance ever since. He's also gone completely crazy. And what he ends up doing is he starts capturing the loved ones of these two noblemen, capturing their women, skinning them alive, and making lanterns out of them.
Mm-hmm.
And cool. But of course the two nobles think that it's the other guy who's doing it to them because they're so hyper competitive. And so there's lots and lots of fights and flying around, bouncing off the walls, swinging swords. And then when the crazy guy, the lantern craftsman, shows up, he's in like a monkey suit with a skull face and comes out. He's got razor claws like Wolverine from the X-Men. and of course you get all the lackeys who just get dispatched horribly. Lots of swinging swords, lots of decapitations, trigger warning. There's kind of a nasty rape scene.
Ooh.
So yeah. Beware of that. But apart from that, it's sumptuous to look at. It's classic Kung Fu. It's definitely horror. It's the moments where the victims get skinned are pretty nasty.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's the thing that's so great about the later Shaw Brothers films too, is that when you got into, because pretty much all the way through the 1980s, mm-hmm. the blood was super jokey, the blood was super fake. Mm-hmm. But when they got into the early 80s, yep. it was like no holds barred. Yep. They went crazy,
yes, they
crazy
did.
With mm-hmm. stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think they... You know, when the Shaw brothers sort of came of age, they'd been doing it in the 60s, but in the 70s when the
Shaw brothers studio was started?
When was it, 50 something?
1925.
No way.
1925. Wow. Ran from 1925 to 2011. Mm-hmm. They kind of the tap really ran dry in 1986.
Yeah.
And that was because Golden Harvest was
yes.
was applying so much pressure to them, and they were getting like completely duped because of all of the bootlegs and copyright infringement of their stuff that they just kind of like started. They pretty much in 1986 they kind of started just mm-hmm. give up.
Yeah.
But yeah, the golden age was the 1960s and 1970s, but they actually started the production of film in 1925.
Yeah, the stuff that you you will be able to find, and I will say Human Lanterns is hard to find. It is not on Tubi. Mm-hmm. It is not on Apple, on Amazon.
I definitely came across that title when I was researching.
Yeah. I had to go to Movie Madness.
Yeah.
It is a remarkably good looking film. It is a completely entertaining film, and it's got a bunch of the guys who will go,
yeah,
you know, these cackles.
Gotta love that.
And then both of the lords will like they'll point accusing fingers at each other and then bring out a sword.
Huge eyebrows and yeah, man buns.
Yeah. Yeah. No. And great costumes. Lots of traditional kung fu tropes, and it's actually unlike a lot of the other things that we've been talking about. It's a story that kind of you can follow the story pretty well. You don't get lost with this one. So yeah, Human Lanterns, 1982, Shaw Brothers. Cool. Check it out.
All right, my first film of the night is a film that was the sequel to Bewitched and is also known as Black Magic 4. This is The Boxer's Omen from 1981.
Oh.
I dare Hollywood, if you are listening, I dare you to try to remake this film. You cannot. This film features demon bats, spiders, eels emerging from people's mouths, strange insects burrowing into people's openings, alligators being cut open so that corpses can be stuffed inside.
Oh, yeah.
Supernatural vistas, magical terror attacks, flying eyeball creatures, wild clashes with demonic entities, conjuring up spells that require people to spit up blood, piercing eyeballs with needles, mummified corpse, and so much vomit, and people eating the vomit that was just vomited. Like,
get
I kept
out the dustpan,
John Waters would be proud. Yeah,
I kept looking at it going, Oh, no, no. They're regurgitating this to try to resurrect this specific demon. And I kept looking to see if they were editing between scenes. They weren't. So it's like one guy is vomiting up stuff and then the next guy is eating it. But the film, in the most simple terms, because this is the most fever dream of all films I have ever seen, involves a boxer from Thailand, a boxer from an actual like sort of kickboxer, a kickboxer from China. The boxer from Thailand beats the crap out of this boxer from China, and then the brother of the boxer from China seeks revenge. He goes to Thailand to try to seek revenge, and he learns that he is the twin, the ancient twin of a super powerful Buddhist monk who has a whole army of black magic being plied against him. From there, I could not tell you a goddamn thing about this film because it goes so far off the rail with, as I said, flying heads, maggots, oodles of vomit. And it seems that so much of the black magic is tied to vomit and magic, vomit and maggots, not magic, vomit and maggots. Yeah, it's kind of, the whole thing is really shocking to me because I've never seen a film like this.
So confused.
It's like John Waters has entered the kung fu arena.
Or like the guy who made Queen of Black Magic. Yeah.
Teamed up. Is that Timo Jajanto?
Timo
Sandoval?
It's honest.
Timo Tejanto will show up in a little bit.
Honest to God, it is like nothing I have ever seen. And I think Boxer's Omen is truly the weirdest. It's one of the weirdest films of all time. I would say it's definitely the weirdest kung fu movie of all time.
Now you had to go to Movie Madness for this one, I bet, because this is not.
Yeah,
it is not streaming anywhere.
Available.
Yeah.
So these are all recommendations for you to really have to go digging for
it.
Or if you happen to live in a city with a lot of sort of Hong Kong cinema stuff available.
I will say Shout TV, if you are interested in physical copies, Shout TV has quite a bit of the Shaw Brothers collection. I'm not sure if Boxer's Omen is one of the things, but cool. You can go to Shout TV and they have a lot of that stuff. Moving on to Liz for your second film of the night.
Okay. You're going to have to get in the mood. It's 1995. You got your glow sticks. You're going to the rave and you're going to yell out, Mortal Kombat! Start dancing. So I am talking about 1995's Paul W.S. Anderson directed martial arts fantasy action horror film, Mortal Kombat. Okay, so this is based on the video game. Finish him. Yeah, this is based on the video game and the simple plot is that Mortal Kombat is a generational tournament between Earth and the Outworld realms, and people from Earth go over to the Outworld to fight ridiculous-looking characters, and they are shepherded along the way by Lord Raiden, played by Christopher Lambert. And this stars Robin Shu as Liu Kang. We've got Lyndon Ashby as Johnny Cage, and we have Brigitte Wilson as Sonya Blade. Those are our three main heroes, and they're going to go over and they're going to fight Sub-Zero and Scorpion and Kano and Kitana. So just get yourself behind the joystick of the video game and get ready for Mortal Kombat. Do not watch the 2021 remake of Mortal Kombat. It is terrible. Go back to the 90s. It holds up. It is a very silly.
It's a time capsule movie, really.
It is a time capsule. Oh my gosh. Liu Kang's hair is a time capsule. It's so bizarre. But after that, you can pair this with Beverly Hills Ninja, also starring Robin Shu in a martial arts role, playing opposite the late, great Chris Farley. Aww. So Mortal Kombat and Beverly Hills Ninja would be two martial arts films that would go together. And I love Mortal Kombat. Yep. It's so much fun. Paul Anderson is a little treasure in the silly horror video game movie adaptation world, because he did
Resident Evil. Yeah.
So I guess he was a gamer and said, wait, I can make these into movies. But he also did Event Horizon, yeah, which
and,
is one of my
and
favorites.
And the soundtrack is
so good. It, I mean, it's the 90s.
Instant recognition. Yeah, and yeah.
That's what I call music.
Yeah. Part three. Yeah. It is instantly recognizable. And I apologize, though, because if you rewatch this movie, you will have that in your head for at least a week and be walking around your house just saying, finish him.
Mortal Kombat warning. So,
Mortal Kombat warning. Yeah, it will be stuck in your head. That is my number two pick.
Love
silly,
it.
Fun.
Okay, for my number two, I am going to advance a few years from where I from my previous movie. This is a Twi Hark classic. This is and Mike alluded to this in his previous commentary that the Shaw brothers started slowing down and were largely pushed out of the game in 1986. In 1987, so this is when I really started getting into Hong Kong cinema with where you got introduced to Jet Li and and Donnie Yen and a lot of Jackie Chan.
Yep.
But one of my favorites, and it still holds up, is A Chinese Ghost Story.
Oh, yeah.
From 1987, starring Leslie Cheung, Joey Wong, and Wu Ma. And the story is, after a string of bad luck, a debt collector has no other choice than to spend the night in a haunted temple, where he encounters a ravishing female ghost, and later battles to save her soul from the control of a wicked tree demon. Pretty good synopsis. That is the so that's the IMDb synopsis.
Sure, sure.
And you know, Leslie Cheung at this time was sort of a baby faced hero who's, you know, he's going from town to town as a just trying to get collect the taxes, but nobody wants him in town. They say, get out of town, you loser. And so he has to brave a bunch of wolves and stumbles into this temple where he finds the ghost who is Joey Wong, and there's a lot of fun gags involving, you know, she falls in love with him and she tries to hide him from her ghostly sisters. And meanwhile, there's a swordsman in the temple who is hunting the ghosts, trying to chop their heads off. And at the same time, there's a this tree demon has a bunch of these zombies hiding around in this temple who sneak around, and they unknown to nobody can see them. And so Leslie Cheung's character, the debt collector, is constantly like breaking, like accidentally closing doors and crunching the zombies, and they go and they crumble, or that they're sneaking up on him and he opens up a window in his daytime and then they sort of melt into nothing and he goes, oh, that's what I was looking for. And
are they fast zombies or slow zombies?
Oh, they're totally slow zombies. They're crawling. They're like corpses, right? But you also see that there was at the beginning of the movie there's a fight between this legendary swordsman and the guy and another legendary swordsman who's in the temple, and after one of them gets defeated, the other one walks away and is like, ha ha ha, I won, kind of a thing. And then the tree demon attacks the loser, who's he's wounded but he's not dead yet, and he turns him into this husk of a corpse, and so he's one of those things that's crawling around trying to chase after.
Yeah,
this is by many considered to be one of the great kung fu movies of the era.
Yeah,
and it's not just kung fu horror, but it is a lot of fun. It's really well produced. This also introduced the age of a lot of the wire work that would inspire things like Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
Flying the ghosts. It's like so the ghosts had these flowing robes and lots of banners, lots of robes. So sort of the ruffle of the robes. Period piece thing, so it's like from 14th century. I don't know what my dynasties well enough, but
sure.
It is lots of, you know, the nighttime fighting action. Everything seems cast in blue. So there's an era in Hong Kong cinema where things sort of went blue,
right?
And but they would they'd leap out and they'd yell at each other and they'd start not that kind of a blue. But there's there is it's a little racy, you know, there's a lot of the ghost is gonna take a bath now, but subtly sort of hiding the any naughty bits. So it's kind of PG-13-ish.
Okay. You know what's crazy too is they did a ton of Chinese ghost stories. I don't know how many have you seen.
I've seen three of them.
There's like five, and then they did like a reboot of the Chinese ghost story.
So be careful because the ones that they not surprising, diminishing returns. The original is the best.
Sure.
And it's fun. It's a lot of fun, and you almost don't need to read the translations because the acting is so broad and it's fun to watch, especially when like the sequences where he's being unknowingly pursued by these zombies that he's sort of dispatching by accident.
Mm-hmm. Funny you say that about the translations, because Hank walked in on me watching Boxer's Omen the other night and he said, "Do you even really need to have subtitles on?"
Not the one that you just watched. Because
he's like, this doesn't make any sense anyway. No,
I think the thing for a Chinese ghost story, and I think one of the reasons why it's beloved, is it has a strong through line. It's a love. The love story is great.
Yeah.
And because this guy is not a fighter.
Right.
But he will learn to fight for the ghost that he loves. But it's also the thing that he doesn't. It's like, how do you not know that she's a ghost?
Yeah.
But, because it's like, your skin is so cold. It's like, because that's why I was just in the lake and I got out. Oh, okay.
Yeah. Right.
I got a chance to rewatch it again this week.
Yeah.
And I was like, that's right. I love this movie. So, a Chinese ghost story. It's a classic. Check it out. You should be able to find this one online.
Yep. Get the 1987 version.
Yeah.
All right. The next film, speaking of blue, is called Seeding of a Ghost from 1983. This is a horror kung fu film directed by Chon Yang, also known as Black Magic 5. And this is, man, this is straight up and down grindhouse and very, very bosomy and very, 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 very steeped in exploitation. It involves a Hong Kong taxi driver whose life falls apart when he accidentally hits a black magic sorcerer. Later, he learns the taxi driver, which, you think, how the hell did a sorcerer get hit? But the sorcerer got hit.
Seriously.
He's not adapted to the 20th century.
That's right. But the taxi driver finds out that his wife has been cheating on him, and so he decides to employ the black magic sorcerer to get revenge on all the people, to get revenge on his wife and all the people that, spoiler alert, were involved in the killing of his wife. The film is pretty remarkable. It's not as bonkers per se as The Boxer's Omen, but there is black magic, there are devils, there are tentacle monsters, there are worms, and there's everything else that you would expect from sort of hell itself, right? Mm-hmm. The final 10 minutes or so involves a series of families playing mahjong in an apartment when a thing like, and this of course was hot on the heels of John Carpenter's Thing, a thing like creature is released, the tentacle head, is released on this family of people playing mahjong, these couple families playing together, but it comes out of a woman. And so not only does the thing creature come out of, she sort of burrs this thing, right? They also took that, they were like, oh, well, John Carpenter, he kind of stopped here. Let's try to like figure out how to ratchet up this thing like as far as we possibly could. And they actually do in really shocking ways. So it's not just her stomach exploding and this thing coming out, but then the thing, there's a baby within the thing head, the thing tentacle monster head that proceeds to
body horror
attack everyone. Yeah. I would say, I know this is going to sound insane, but I would say it rivals and possibly exceeds Cronenberg's The Fly and The Thing in terms of just the wildness of it.
Okay.
Yeah, it's shocking. It is really shocking. The Seeding of a Ghost, of course, is a Shaw Brothers film as well. And as I was sort of talking a little bit about earlier, you know, when they got into the 1980s, they had a little bit more of a budget. They had a little bit more latitude. They were willing to show nudity. They were willing to show exploitation. They were willing to show
graphic gore.
And man, did they ever.
Is there much fighting in this?
There is a couple fighting scenes because they eventually have to employ some other good sorcerers to counterbalance the dark sorcerers. And so there's a pinch of fighting. I made sure that there was fighting in every single one of my kung fu horror films so that it wasn't just a Chinese-based horror film or a Hong Kong horror film, but that there was indeed fighting. And there is indeed fighting in Seeding of a Ghost from 1983. Liz, what is next on your list?
Okay. This movie made my top 10 horror movies of 2018, and this is, yes,
okay.
Timo Tejanto's The Night Comes for Us.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
This is probably one of the most violent movies I have ever seen in my entire life. And it stars Joe Taslim, who is an Indonesian martial artist. He was on the Indonesian national judo team from 1997 to 2009 as Ito. And he is a former member of the Six Seas Triad, who is on the run from the triad after he saves a young girl from a village where they have just massacred everyone in said village. That's pretty much the plot. So the triad is going to be sending everybody after him to get him. And for the next 2 hours, he is just going to have to defend himself. And it is bloody, 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 bloody,
yes!
bloody. Holy moly, is it bloody? It is gorgeously choreographed fight scenes. So you're going to get your money's worth with this one. And so much so that when we did our lightning round and I misread cinematography and thought it said choreography, I picked this movie. That's how good these scenes look. I mean, but this is so different from the old ones that you're talking about. These fight scenes are so fast. I mean, you are just like looking back and forth. Blood is flying everywhere. It is, oh my God, it's a freaking really, really good movie, just soaked in blood.
The Indonesians have sort of, I think at the beginning of this century, with the raid.
Mm-hmm. He's the star of the raid also.
Yeah, so this is, their fight choreography is wild.
It is fantastic, and he's also in Fast and Furious 6.
Ooh,
so
good job.
But he does, and he's in the remake of Mortal Kombat from 2021.
And I think he's going to be in Expendables 4, I think.
Oh, that would be a great addition to that.
I think they have him and Tony Jaa. I mean, frankly, the Expendables, those guys are really, really
real old
now. And Bruce Willis is, I don't know, I think he's bedridden now. So, you know.
Yeah.
They got some fresh blood. And actually, if you're going to want some fighting, Southeast Asia. That's where you can go. Jet Li is probably too old to be doing a lot of the things but that whole move, that franchise is about old heroes.
Old guys, yeah. And this also is stars Aiko Uwais, who is another stuntman, martial artist, and he's in The Raid 2.
I have not seen this one, but it is on my list. So, have you seen it?
You have not seen Night Comes for Us?
No, but
it's on Netflix.
I know, it's
so
on my list.
Raid,
it is on
Redemption
my list.
And The Raid 2. All of them are worth watching. They're, you know, Mike, I would normally say this movie is too long. Not this one. It's 2 hours of nonstop blood and fighting.
All right.
And it's a pretty simple plot, but there's just so many characters because they all got to keep coming after him. You got to have a large cast to keep replacing the bodies. So The Night Comes for Us. Woo. Great film. Super bloody. See it.
Done. Okay. So I'm, and I do have a backup just in case I collide with Mike here.
Oh.
But this is where two worlds collide.
Oh.
You're taking two legendary film houses coming together, Hammer.
Oh,
and,
yeah.
And the Shaw Brothers.
Yeah.
This is The Legend of the Seven Golden Vampires.
Yeah, Hobbin Vampires.
So did you pick this one?
No,
okay, did not. Yeah. So we'll bring this one up. This is, it stars Peter Cushing,
yeah.
who does a great job. He's really good in this.
But he's only in it for a hot second.
No, he's actually in it for quite a bit. He's one of the central figures, yeah. And it's got David Chang, Jewel Egy, who's a Swedish model,
right.
And Han Cheng Wang. And the story here is, while lecturing in China, Van Helsing, Peter Cushing, agrees to help seven kung fu trained siblings reclaim their ancestral mountain village, now the domain of seven powerful vampires and their army of undead slaves. So it really feels like it is both a Shaw Brothers movie and a Hammer movie, which...
Yeah.
These are two grand houses of grindhouse, right? There's a nice alliteration. This is, you know, it has a strong homage to something like The Seven Samurai.
Yeah.
Where there or Hidden Fortress. It's a save the town from the vampires. And Van Helsing is there to offer all of his wisdom. And it's, you know, initially they also have actually Count Dracula is a central figure here. And they open up with, and they offered the role to Christopher Lee, but he saw the script and went, no, thank you. but it's actually better than you would expect given sort of the strange mashup that they attempted. So the actual Euro Dracula is only in the... The Dracula is only in the movie for a hot second. That might be what
oh,
you were,
sure,
what you were
sure.
thinking
okay.
about.
Yeah.
But he has a Khan who is a disciple of Dracula, goes to Dracula's castle, which looks like the outskirts of Hong Kong, right? Like the mountains. It's like, that doesn't look like Romania, but they say Romania over the title. And he goes over and he asks for Dracula's support in becoming a dark, you know, the
right.
vampire lord in China. And instead what Dracula does is he consumes this guy and takes his form.
Mm-hmm.
And so he is Dracula.
Right, right, right.
And then, but I think that it was great because when they establish, you know, because classically the cross being something that will repel Dracula, the Van Helsing says it's a spiritual power. And so in this case, it would be Lord Buddha. And so they'd use Buddhist symbols to fight off the vampires. And this comes from the tradition that was established of some hoppy vampires.
Yeah.
They're not as hoppy as like Spooky Encounters will do hoppy vampires.
Sure.
But they're kind of goggle-eyed, kind of like scarred flesh vampires that sort of, they are not the sexy vampires. They are sort of rotten looking vampires.
And they do some hopping.
They do a little bit of hopping that they do more marching that they shuffle and they bounce a little bit. The family of martial artists are so much fun to watch. They're archetypes, right? They're known by their weapons. Like, this is the guy with the spear. This is the guy with the big hammer. These are the twins who use the swords together. It's a combined effort. This is the pretty, sexy female martial artist who the younger Van Helsing falls in love with. And so there's a lot of these kinds of, and again, it feels like the, In Hammer movies, usually there's a young apprentice who falls in love with a young woman, and they become sort of the side story. That happens here, except for it's across, and it's like Euro Asian kind of matchup, and Van Helsing falls in love it feels like a really terrific merger of those two things. The fighting doesn't disappoint. It's great, great chop socky action,
mm-hmm.
and and it's kind of the Hammer stuff where you get a lot of the vampire bloodletting ceremonies,
mm-hmm.
and it's It really feels like if you're a fan of either house, you'll really be happy with it. It has limitations. The characters are, with the exception of Van Helsing, are pure cardboard.
Yeah.
But it is fun. It is a movie that will hold your attention and is fun from the opening scene to the closing moments. It doesn't spare our crew. It's surprising.
Mm-hmm.
Who gets it?
Yeah.
Loved it. So once again, The Legend of the Seven Golden Vampires, a grindhouse classic.
Oh my gosh, is it ever? Yeah. I saw a 35 millimeter print of this at the Hollywood a couple years ago. And yeah, Dan Halstead talked a lot about how this mashup came together. It really was kind of a one and done. They didn't do much beyond, but it was Hammer recognizing that they didn't know how to do Kung Fu, and then the Shaw brothers recognizing that they needed more horror because both of those two things were very popular.
Yep.
And so they really drew on each other to try to figure this out.
It was a marriage
out.
Of convenience.
Yeah. But both at the other thing too was at the same time, both of those production studios were kind of on the skids. They were on the decline. Mm-hmm. And this, they both felt that this was a way to sort of like bring it back to life.
To use
horror parlance.
It kept them on life support for a while.
Yeah. All right. The last film I'm going to talk about is from 1975. This is a film called Black Magic. Mm. This is a Hong Kong kung fu horror film directed by Ho Meng Hua. And this sequel was released in 1976. I think there are, if I'm doing my math right, I think there are 6 or 7 Black Magic films. Okay. So this is a franchise that kept on going. This one involves a widow who gets more than she bargained for when she asks an evil magician to help her snare a handsome young engineer, maybe an architect. I don't know.
Because that's, you know, yeah. We're in hot demand.
That's right. Mm-hmm. But complications arise when she decides... the black magic sorcerer decides that he wants the bride for himself. The film is great because, as I mentioned, it has many of the same things I've been talking about, including self-mutilation, grisly black magic rituals involving freshly buried corpses. It involves putrid flesh, maggots, and all sorts of sleazy rituals. This one includes not one, but 2 scenes of black magic ritual involving women providing breast milk. True story.
No.
Yeah. And you think all the other things I've said are, you know, this was like, obviously, women's breast milk is not gross, and I would never mean to imply that it is gross.
But you don't see that in the movies much.
You don't see it in the movies, and that in and of itself is shocking. But it also involves centipede eating and all sorts of other grotesque imagery that will carry on through all the other black magic films. Yeah, it's a shocking one. It has many of the same pieces and parts, of course, of A Seeding of a Ghost from 1983, and it has many of the pieces and parts of every single kung fu movie. Revenge is at the core of literally every single. In fact, I would argue that you can't find a kung fu film that is not devoid of revenge. This has lots and lots of revenge elements, but there is a great and very 1970s-esque scene at the end of the film involving the good and the bad wizards at a construction site, courtesy of the architect and the good and bad wizards. Somehow all
There's
of
a
us,
running theme with your movies. There's
yeah,
a lot
I know.
Of, yes.
They all have wizards?
Yeah.
Good and bad wizards.
The good and bad wizards have a sort of a kung fu fight, but it's like lasers, but it's maybe lightning. It's kind of a mix of things. It's a mixed bag of fighting elements. Black Magic is super duper good. It is super duper gory. Like all these films, I'm still shocked at some of the things I saw when I wandered down this path of kung fu horror and the amount of gore and not just, you know, not just sort of like different cultural looks and feels, but man, shocking stuff. Shocking stuff in the world of kung fu horror. All right, so why don't we go through, since these films are hard to get,
yes,
have often confusing and different sounding names, why don't we go through our list, starting with Liz?
Okay, mine are the accessible films you can actually see.
That's
right. Okay, we're starting with 2011's Monster Brawl, the monster wrestling
movie.
That
sounds so fun.
It is. It's very fun. Then we're going to 1995's Mortal Kombat, and wrapping it up with 2018's Indonesian action thriller horror, The Night Comes for Us, and that is available on Netflix.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay, so my films, I have the 1982 Shaw Brothers feature Human Lanterns. This one will be hard to find. It's worth, if you're a kung fu fan, this is definitely one to go search out. You might have to go physical media for this one. A Chinese Ghost Story from 1987 by Tui Hark. This was the second golden age of Hong Kong, and really one of the landmark kung fu films. It's a lot of fun, sweet story. Go check that out. That one might be available. I don't know where you can find it, but this one should. This is a big enough movie that you should be able to find it at some point. I think right now it's it might be on Netflix or something like that, because it's not on. Or actually, I tried to search for it on Netflix, and it says it's owned by somebody else or Amazon, and then I couldn't find who's got it, but it's out there streamable by somebody. Then I also have the Hammer Shaw Brothers matchup, The Legend of the Seven Golden Vampires. You can get this one on available streaming.
Yeah. All right. My list of films included Black Magic 4, a.k.a. The Boxer's Omen from 1981. Seeding of a Ghost, a.k.a. Black Magic 5 from 1983, and Black Magic from 1975. You go.
And I'm just going to run through some of the other ones. Through my research, some things and some of the Western martial arts things. Upgrade from 2019 has some terrific... And the fighting in that is really
correct.
Cool. John Carpenter enters the picture with Big Trouble in Little China, which is sort of more fantasy than horror, but it's, I think, along the lines of some of the stuff that I was talking about. It's got, that one is pure fun. That's a cult classic. Tokyo Gore Police, going to Japan. Versus, which is a Ryuhei Kitamura revenge weird
FYI
time travel.
FYI on Versus, if you are renting it from Amazon... Don't. It has no subtitles. I experienced that.
Okay. Yeah, that one. Yeah. So that, but that one is like lots of swinging blades action. Speaking of blades, Blade 2, I think my favorite of the Blade franchise. Because that one's Guillermo del Toro, who's the best of the directors trying to attempt that franchise. A shout out, and I forget the name of our friend who we did, Ricky O, The Story of Ricky.
Oh, yeah.
Which is, I think, a lot like what Liz is talking about relative to just a martial arts bloodbath. Brotherhood of the Wolf with John DeCascos. Is that the actor's name? He's the chairman from the kitchen fight.
See, I don't remember fighting in that.
No, that was it's really weird because he's this Filipino guy who's supposed to be a Cherokee guy who's a martial artist. It's really incongruous, but it's kind of cool looking. Brotherhood of the Wolf looks better than the story goes.
And Pascal Legier is the DP, I think, on that one.
Yeah, and it shows. Yeah. I mean, it's a gorgeous film. The story makes no sense. But Brotherhood of the Wolf's got some good martial arts. Rigor Mortis, a more modern. Kung Fu, darker story, really good, more horror than Kung Fu. I almost went with that one as a talking point.
You did talk about Rigor Mortis when we talked about Asian horror.
Yeah. Really bleak, great story.
Yeah.
Kung Fu Killer, Donnie Yen, which is a serial killer, is killing off all the greatest martial artists.
Mm-hmm.
There's that. And then lastly, two movies that you can't get, but and one of Spooky Encounters, which is one of our top 100s, or was.
At was.
And Mr. Original. Vampire, Hopping Vampires. Legend. That is two classic ones that are really hard to find, and I hope Arrow or Vinegar Syndrome or somebody picks them up on physical media.
Yeah.
Anyways, that is my rundown.
All right. I'm going to take us out of here with an Americanized or a Westernized tagline from Black Magic. Those who did not believe in the voodoo curse never lived to tell.